begin was preordained, a mighty plan that I should walk with him alone, the cords of trust unbroken. But fate foresaw my wandering eye that none could yet restrain.
Coming up in the Garden of Eden tonight. Yes, please. I'm here. Yes, I can hear you. You can say whatever you want to say.
Hi. How are you going to hear what I'm going to say when you're facing that?
I am here. How come I'm responding if I'm not able to hear what you're saying? I'm here. I'm responding. What is it?
Are these jeans?
Do not touch me, by the way.
But why would you come to bed in jeans?
This is my body. I can choose to wear whatever I want to wear anytime, anywhere.
Sweetheart.
Which sweetheart? What is it?
Okay. Which other sweetheart do I have?
What is it? What do you want?
What would I want at this time?
You know what?
No, I don't know.
I am really, really, really tired.
Tired? Of what?
The way you come every night and you just come and... Sweetheart, sweetheart, turn around. Every time. That is all you know how to do, sweetheart. Turn around, turn around, turn around. Put for me.
Yeah, so you want me to carry
you over? Will not be getting anything tonight.
Why not? Are you not my wife?
I thought I were until you failed to perform your husband duties in this bedroom.
What do you mean I failed to perform
when
we have four kids?
That's when you said to be my husband.
Yeah? We have four kids and you're saying I'm not performing.
Indeed, children.
Yeah, the results are children.
Do you understand the purpose of sex?
Purpose of sex?
Do you even know how it is supposed to be done? Do you even have an idea or you think children, children, children? You think sex is all about children?
Yes, what else do I want sex for? I want children to enjoy and that is it.
Okay, if you want to have more kids tonight, we are not making any babies. Please.
So what am I supposed to do? Have sex from someone else?
I don't know. Please, just help yourself because I am tired. I have tried to be nice and explain to you. I even get to do some research, read some books. I bought this book. I asked you understand what you're supposed to do as a husband in this bed. Learn something. I am tired of every time just put honey, honey, honey. As if you're just some lion grabbing a
prey. I'm supposed
please,
to go,
please.
Fend for the family, take care of you, take care of the children, and also do research about something that you are supposed to do. It is your obligation. We are married.
That is exactly my point.
What are you
doing
here?
Because I have been suffering in this bed. You do not listen to me. You don't care about my needs. You don't even know how I was, what I was thinking about, what I went through throughout the day. You just want to come and you find me in the bed. Sweetheart, sweetheart. Then I put, you do whatever you want to do. You just walk away every time.
Have you asked me how my day has been?
Throughout the 10 years of marriage. And this is what you do every time. For you think it is just a matter of coming and we go into this bed and do whatever makes you happy, not me. You don't care on how to prepare me, to make me ready for, so they can also enjoy.
But I'm not your singer to start preparing you. If they did not do that for you, that's your problem.
Ignorance of purpose makes abuse inevitable. See?
To have sex with our wives, we have to read books. Isn't this wonderful?
You're not ready to understand a role of a husband in the bedroom as far as satisfying your wife is concerned, forget having anything. I am tired of being just exploited and used and abused.
Exploited? Please. I'm taking care of you. You have everything you want and you're saying
See,
exploited.
You're not even listening to me. Are you listening to me?
Yes, I've had everything.
You are
exploited.
What
read
have
books.
I said? Okay, what have I said?
Very soon I'm going to find a big blackboard here.
No, what am I complaining about? You can, this is our bedroom, but we are raising our voices. We are supposed to be enjoying one another, making me happy, meeting my emotional needs. But when I try to explain, you want me to come out and be... Anyway, am I wasting my
speaking
energy?
In parables?
There is the book. Get it and read and know what you ought to do in the bedroom as a man.
I don't want your book. You can keep it.
Get out, eh? Just go sleep in the couch where people that do not know how to be husbands sleep, eh? When you're ready
no,
to
you
be
can
a
sleep in the couch.
Get out. Go and tell me. Using me every time.
I can also fight
get
back.
Get out of this bed. Just leave me alone. Or I can just get out and leave you in your bed.
You go.
Please.
Go.
Go. I am tired. You won't be getting anything. Forget it.
You take care of the family. You come back, you're being preached to. You might as well get a blackboard and show me whatever you want.
It's okay. It's fine. It's fine.
Oh, dear God. Why do I have to go through this?
Anymore.
Good night. Silly woman.
Useless husband. You know, you don't want to learn. You want to come put every night. Put. You don't want to care how I feel every night. Put. What's wrong with men of nowadays? Eh? They think you just come in the bedroom and satisfy yourself. Selfishness. The wives have suffered. Every night. The husband will come and do shoddy work. Underperformance. That is what I call it. Because the husband is not willing to listen to the wife. They think they know. Selfishness of the highest order. They're supposed to be the leader in the bedroom. And then they think because, yes, you see, we are having children. You see, darling, turn every time. It is high time that a husband will wake up and do what they ought to do in this bed. Because the Lord God who created this gift and gifted it to husband and wife, he has a procedure. It is clearly laid out. But women are crying every night. And the husband is not listening. They think the wife is just overly demanding. It's painful. But tonight, in the garden, we hope that the husband that is watching is going to be able to learn something right here tonight, as even as you can see your marriage anchor getting into the acting and making sure that you get a feel of what women go through at the hands of a husband that is not willing to do a little bit of research, read a book, consult somebody, make your wife happy, wipe the tears. You promised to do this. Why not? You are welcome to the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, Prosy Buyondo. Said you are welcome to the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, Prosy Buyondo. I want to cover my face. Eh? Do you know why I want to cover my face? Eh? I even can't believe that I did what I just did a minutes ago right here in the garden. But yes, I felt this is something that I had to do myself. Why did I do that? Maybe you're wondering, marriage anchor, what were you doing? Yes, I was representing hundreds, thousands, millions of women that have been crying right here in their bedroom. Every night they cry, and guess who? Some of them, of course, they cry to the marriage anchor, and they call and they are complaining, marriage anchor, my husband underperformance, my husband, he doesn't know what to do, my husband, he pretends he's an expert, my husband, my bedroom matters have become bedroom matters. That is why even for this very episode I said, okay, what can I do to represent the lady that does not have an ear, somebody to listen to them and actually consider their dissatisfaction and do something about it. So your marriage anchor tonight decided she's going to take matters into her own hands and do something about it. Yes, above and over the excitement, I am very disappointed. Yes, I am disappointed at every husband that is not making an effort to understand the art of making love. Yes, tonight in the garden, we are talking about the art of making love, all that drama that you saw at the very beginning, is a part of the package that we have packaged for, yes, we, me and the Lord Jesus Christ, the author of marriage, the gifter of intercourse, of the ministry of worship. Yes, he is so concerned. He is tired of tears coming from numerous women, wives that are crying because there's some dissatisfaction. They are not tasting any of heaven's romance. So tonight in the garden, my job is pretty simple, very precise. As you see me in this bed, I am going to be a little bit straightforward. So at this point, I am going to ask, if you're watching and you're below 18 and probably you're not married, you may want to sit out this, of course, this episode. Why? Because I'm going to get a little bit tough on the things that I'm going to discuss as far as the ministry of worship. Of course, when you see me on the bed, I've told you before, when you see the bed, just so you know, marriage anchor, we are going into the garden to do some farming. So Miss Farmer, Miss Garden, take the children to bed, set yourself up, get some coffee and open your ears really, really sharply, because I do not want anybody that is crying because someone does not know what they ought to do in the bedroom. So I have a few questions that I want to respond to, questions that have come from you, yes, the followers of the Marriage Anchor of the Garden of Eden TV show, yes, on Facebook. You send in your WhatsApp messages, so I've summarized some of them and I want to answer them right here so that you will know what you ought to do. If you're married and your husband or your wife is not watching with you at this point, just call them, tell them, where are you? Make sure, because you can watch online, yes, UBC Facebook Live, and you're able to follow us and watch again. Tell them the Marriage Anchor is here. She's talking about the art of making love. Yes, she's in the bedroom. You do not want to miss out on this one. Okay, let me start with your questions. And this one is saying, hello, Marriage Anchor. My husband is not passionate in bed. I am always bored most of the times. How can you advise us? We are started with bedroom boredom. So how do we remove, how do we eliminate? What is the solution to ending bedroom boredom, especially when the husband is not passionate enough? Now, for this specific question, I'm going to refer you to an episode that I did, I think, months back. It is available on our Facebook page, which is Sex and Affection. Now, Sex and Affection, I did a full episode, so that is about 40 or 45 minutes of presentation. I cannot summarize it in just answering this question. But what can I say? If you have a husband that is not passionate in bed, passionate enough, the very first thing that you have to do is talk about it. Watch the Marriage Anchor, for example. Talk about it. Just ensure that you sit your husband. You call them to attention. Do not die in silence. The very first step is express yourself, communication. I did something the other season, I think, about intimate communication. Express what you feel to your husband, to your wife. Yes, there are even wives that are not, you know, passionate enough. Talk about it. If you're not free to the person that, you have not your clothes on, I mean, who are you going to open up to? Because you're supposed to be that close that there's nothing you hide from them. So if there's something that you love and you want to enjoy in this bed, you're not willing to talk about it or even share your feelings, I mean, who are you going to tell? So the first step to any couple that is facing dissatisfaction, just talk to your spouse first. Express what you feel. Once you express what you feel, find out, why are they not doing that? Is it because they are ignorant or they are selfish? Yes, there are those that are selfish, others are ignorant. So if there is ignorance, then you look for sources of information, how you can equip yourself to making sure that you don't miss out, yes, on what the Shulamite and Solomon enjoy as we look at the book of Song of Songs. So that is my response for you. Some of these things we do not know. Nobody is an expert. Even I did not know most of the things that I know now. But I have taken time to consult from the Holy Spirit, study His Word. Of course, I've read some books. There's a book that, you know, I have been reading. And yes, I recommended Sex Code. Mm-hmm. I've been reading that book and it has taught me a lot. Go ahead and find literature. Yes. Literature that is founded on the foundation of God, and equip yourself so that you are not ignorant. So a husband that is not passionate, I cannot really tell him what he must do, but you must somehow understand and examine the factors surrounding their lack of passion in your bedroom. Okay, I'll just read for you a verse right here as far as passion is concerned. Maybe just like you're wondering, where do we start from? Yeah, so let's just read the Song of Solomon chapter 2 verse 7 that says, I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles of the field, do not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. Do not stir up love or awaken it before it pleases. Now, to those of you that are attempting passion, attempting affection, attempting, you know, some new things, creativity before the actual happening, I would encourage you that you shouldn't stir up love before it pleases. Did you watch the act that we did at the very beginning? Yeah, the tendencies of, you know, someone coming and they do not know how you are, they don't know the emotions that are running inside you, because, you know, this intercourse is really emotional. Someone must be feeling good, they must be excited, they must be, you know, in the mood. Yeah, so if anybody wants to be affectionate, passionate, get an outstanding performance, you may want to mind on whether the person is in the right psychological posture. So in other words, do not stir up love until it pleases. In other words, do not engage. First, to do the awakening of love in the garden, right here. Do things that are going to cause the person to feel passionate, to feel excited, to anticipate whatever you're going to do, so that when you come, or when you reach at that moment of doing what you guys know best, then the person or love is awakened. So that is for you. That is Song of Solomon chapter 2 verse 7. They do not awaken love before it pleases, meaning there are people that can attempt the act that we did at the beginning, that can attempt to basically rape. Yes, that summarizes that. Okay, I will just answer this other question, which is, my husband is always quick. I say tonight we are talking about the art of making love. So please, children, go to bed. So some of the things before I read, I'm like, oh my God, I'm on national TV. But don't you worry, I won't be covering my face tonight. Eh? My husband is quick to arrive before I have even started to enjoy. Very short-lived. When I talked to him, he said I should manage that. Oh, I wait for next time, but it has never come. I don't even know how it feels. Yes, people are suffering in the marriage and they cannot even talk about it. So this person is saying, for me, some of the things that I hear people talk about, the excitement of, you know, that connection in the bedroom, the excitement, you know, reaching certain at the apex of things, I just hear about it. I don't even know what it feels to reach at the apex of this experience. I have no idea. I've been married for 20 years. I get those questions. Marriage anchor, we have been married for 20 years, we have 5 children, but I do not know what it means to reach the apex of, you know, the crowning of all things in our bedroom. Why? Because somebody is always on a hurry, he's always, you know, incomplete, inadequate, not enough, not ready, excuse after excuse. So I want to ask you, should we just be silent and not talk about this? You tell me. You be the judge. So what do you do for a person like that? Ignorance of purpose makes abuse inevitable. Let me just give you some Bible verse, which is 1 Corinthians chapter 7
from verse 4 and 5. I told you I'll read scripture for you and give you its interpretation, because unless it is in the Bible, I ain't be talking about it. So if I'm here talking about it, just so you know, it is of God, because that is exactly who I represent. Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 7 from verse 4 to 5 that says, "The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does." Mm-hmm. In other words, Mr. Husband, or the husband or the wife, the body that you have is actually not your own. You belong to the other. This is the word of God, people. You know, some I don't like people that maybe underrate the word of God, and you take it for granted, and you fail to understand what the Bible is saying, and then you go to God in prayer crying for something that he has already clearly stated and showed you how you must do it. The Bible is very clear. This is God, the gifter of marriage, saying that your body as a husband is not yours. It belongs to your wife. In other words, it is for them to do as they please. They can do anything to you at any time, not to hurt you, no, in the areas of satisfaction, satisfying each other. Okay, let's do verse 5. "Do not deprive one another except with consent, and for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again, so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control." In other words, I like the KJV version that says, "Do not defraud," as in it is even, you know, the ladies I used to tell that some wives are sex fraudsters. Like it is labeled, like the Lord is always looking at them and saying, "That one is a fraudster. In bed, she's a thief." A thief, I think, is really petty, but you know, you're a fraudster. You imagine that. So the Bible discourages denying one another, and you must understand that this body is not your own. So if you're just there wanting to do haphazard work and not satisfying each other, you must know that you are there. Your body, whatever you have on your body, is for the satisfaction of the other party, the husband for your wife, the wife for your husband. That is why you are one. That is why you are brought together in the first place. So take your time. Why are you withholding yourself from your wife? Why are you holding yourself or withholding yourself from your husband? Why do you like, you're so mean, you don't want to give of yourself. That is why for you it is just about you. "I will do what I want to do, and you know, get out of here," or "Please wait for next time, maybe we shall see what we can do then," or "I wasn't in the mood." So you have not been in the mood for a full year. Yes, sometimes I just want to pause and let it sink. I let you think about it and know, what do you really want? Do you really want to get married, or you just wanted children? Like, do you even understand what you're doing in that marriage? If your marriage is right here in the bedroom, not anywhere. Anybody can iron clothes. Anybody can provide money. Ladies have learned how to earn their own money. Anybody can do all those other things except right here in the garden, doing some farming. Nobody can do that except. That is why your body is not your own. Why don't you give of yourself wholeheartedly, determined to do that? Why do you want to stop along the way and not talk to your partner, your friend, all the way to the top? Somebody was here telling me, "All the way to the climax." Those are your words. I have not said it. Okay, Mary Janka, "I am really tired of my wife's refusal to go more than one lap. She complains a lot even when I ask once a night. Yet, I have told her boldly that I love to worship as many times as possible. But she says she can't handle my appetite, saying it's too high for her. I am faithful and God-fearing. I can't imagine cheating. But I'm really starved. I am hungry." In other words, is there anything you can recommend to boost my wife's appetite? Okay, now, I will still refer you to the episode I did on sex and affection, because in that episode, you know, see, they go hand in hand. Affection is number one emotional need for the woman. It is really that time when you get to let the emotions to make your wife get to feel you, get to feel excited about you, get to anticipate, and those things, you guys, by the way, when I'm talking about affection, it is not like you don't know these things. You know these things. When I talk about the touch, touch her from her hair all the way to, you know, the sole of her feet, to the very last little, you know, toe of her, you know, foot, and feel every part of her body, just touching her body. Now, is that hard? Like, really? Take your time. Do not rush. I have said these things before in the garden. Just ask her, how was your day? Make sure she's in the right psychological posture. She will even do 20 laps if you wish. For us, the women, it is all about mind stimulation. You just need to turn on the right mood and you will get everything that you want now. Most husbands are very ignorant about affection. When you tell them your wife needs affection in order to give you an outstanding performance, they think, okay, maybe I'll have to have bought her a dress, I'll have to have paid rent. No, this is making sure that she's in the right feelings. You see, mood is a feeling. Is she excited about you? Is she anticipating? Is her body turned on in the first place? Unlike you, the husband or the man, you just look and it is solved. For us, it is my mind has got to be in the game. So take your time to get your wife's mind in the game. And trust me, when her head is in the game, a test of heaven's romance. So the husband that is wondering, she doesn't want to go more than one, please, I want you to take a good look at your wife, just from her head. Look at her hair, compliment her hair, compliment her eyes, look for something very nice on her body, something that you like, by the way, and realistic. Do not, you know, lie to her, because I mean, if you tell me that, Prosy, you have this good, and I'm looking in the mirror and it is a contradiction, I'll be like, oh my god, so you're even trying to lie to me. So just make sure that your compliment is realistic. Look for something beautiful. Is it her hair? Is it the smile? Is it the eyes on her body? Is it her character? Has she been patient with you? Has she been supporting you? Has she been taking care of the kids? As an appreciator. Now, number one, compliment everything that you like about her. Emotional, spiritual, physical. And then also appreciate her for her contribution. First of all, for marrying you, for choosing you, and for being there for you. Now, when I talk about appreciating, just look through the things that she does on a daily. Appreciate those ones. And then also praise her, exalt her. You know that praising is speaking words of encouragement, words of, you know, that will make her feel like, you know, she's the only queen, you know, in your world. Let's just read Song of Solomon chapter 4, actually from verse 1. And this is the husband praising the wife. And he says, behold, you are fair, my love. Behold, you are fair. You have dove's eyes behind your veil. Your hair is like a flock of goats. Your hair, this one, Your hair is like a flock of goats. It is okay if it is like Brazilian, like mine, It's fine, To say that it is like a flock of goats. It's mine because it's on my head. Okay, your hair is like a flock of goats going down from Mount Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of shorn sheep. Now, as you can see, this husband is starting his praise from, you are fair, my love. In other words, you are beautiful, my love. Yeah, you are fair. And then he emphasizes by repeating it. Then he goes to the eyes. Your eyes are like doves behind your veil. Yes, then he's like, your hair is like a flock of goats. And yes, going down. And then your teeth. So he's sloping down all the way. You imagine where that is going to end. And then your teeth are like a flock of shorn sheep, which have come up from the washing, every one of which bears twins, and none is buried among them. Your lips, all the way down, your lips are like a strand of scarlet. Scarlet is red, lipstick. Yes, praise our lipstick. And your mouth is lovely. Your temples behind your veil are like a piece of pomegranate. Your neck is like a tower of David built for an armory, on which hang 1,000 bucklers, all shields of mighty men. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle, which feed among the lilies until the day breaks and shadows flee away. I will go up my way to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill of frankincense. How about I stop here? Do you see this? Some of you, when you read the book of Song of Solomon, you're like, oh my God, let me cover my face, and you want to throw it away. By just me reading what is written here, I know that it inspires something in you. It stirs up something, and there's excitement, there's anticipation. You're like, what is he going to see next? Why wouldn't she do 10 laps for you? Because at the end of every lap, you have to just do the praising again. It is that simple. Turn her on psychologically, and the body will respond accordingly. Biologically, it is proven that for a woman, stimulation is in the mind. So just say things that are going to speak to her, communicate to her mind, the mind communicates the emotions, and then of course some good positive hormones are produced, and the body is ready to run until you have reached the finish line, and you get your trophy. You see? It is that simple. Okay, let me take another question. Dear marriage anchor, I don't know what to do because I am scared I'm losing my husband each passing day. We have lost the sweet intimacy we used to share before I conceived. I am suspecting that the pregnancy has resulted me into disliking making love. I really don't even want him to touch me, even caressing. So now he has become this boring husband. He doesn't even ask about the baby anymore. It's just food, bed, and work. What can I do in my condition to increase my desire for sex? Yes, it has happened. Most women, when they're expecting, things turn upside down. Their hormones, their changes, reactions of their bodies, and yes, medically, yeah, it is proven. Some of them actually lose appetite, some of them dislike certain things. You know, these things they don't want, like the smell of certain things. So there are changes that come with the pregnancy. Now, at this point, I would want to ask the husband, if you love your wife, you will be patient on them and understand that actually some pregnancies, they come with different changes, and you must be willing to wait on them and adapt to these changes and find ways. But also, I don't want you, the wife, to take this for granted. You see, it is just the pregnancy. No, there's always something that you can do. So I would encourage you to first of all consult a medical doctor. Yes, marriage anchor is not, you know, a proven professional doctor, but yes, I know that it is true because it has happened to some of my friends, though it didn't happen to me. But yes, I have met people that just lose appetite for intimacy, for sex, just because they are pregnant and they really want to. So consult a doctor, they test you, and then they will recommend something if it is there. I'm not sure what is available on the market, but yes, do consult a doctor. But also, you can complement your appetite. But most importantly, I know there is power in the imagination of man's heart that can overturn anything. So as your marriage anchor, what I know works for me, and what has worked for some of the ladies that I have met, is that you have to learn to switch on your brain. Learn to use your mind to imagine the things. I call it meditative envisioning. This is something that you have to practice. You have to stimulate your mind by yourself as the wife against the other negative hormones that are trying to, you know, that are presenting a disliking for intimacy. Because, you know, this is very important. I just read you a scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 5 that do not defraud, do not deprive one another, because there's temptation when someone is hungry. You do not know. That is why actually I've met some ladies, not many, but ladies that come and complain that, you see, when I was pregnant, I woke up one day and my husband had an affair with somebody. It is because sometimes, please, a husband, do not clap your hands for this one. But sometimes some men were really, really hungry. And of course they are lacking in self-control, and they couldn't wait for the 9 months, and you know, they did stuff. But of course that is not recommended, because the grace of the Lord is sufficient for you. But you have as a wife, it's your responsibility, because you're there to make your husband happy. So if there is a barrier that is standing in between your happiness, stimulate your mind. Imagine this, think about it, read books. Trust me, what fills a man's heart, somehow, somewhere, the man will do. Your heart, so you're using your heart to imagine. That's why I'm saying, what fills your heart. So if you fill your heart with, for me, I don't have appetite, for me, I don't like this, you see, I'm pregnant, and those are the thoughts in your heart, every little appetite you had will completely die out. But if you say, no, no, I am going to make my husband happy, I am going to be different, I will not, you know, dislike this, I will do everything as how I've been doing them before I conceived, trust me, everything will be done according to your faith. So try and use your mind to imagine and stimulate it and see if that will not work for you. Okay, one of the last questions that I received is, our marriage is on crossroads due to family planning effects, I am sure. Because I started using them when I was okay, the appetite was normal. Now my husband is unhappy because most times I don't feel like it. Even when we do it, it's just for me pretending so that he doesn't feel bad. Yet our baby is still very young, we can't afford another, so please help us. What can we do? So as far as family planning is concerned, I am aware that it also has some side effects, and yes, unfortunately, some of them stand in the way of your pleasure, of the taste of heaven's romance in your bedroom. So number one, again, go and consult a doctor, because the very people that recommended whatever method of family planning that you're using are the very people that can recommend what you need to do, why you need to change. But as far as I'm concerned, I can only tell you one thing. Sex is the marriage. It is priority. Whatever you do, do everything within your power to make sure you do not abstain for long, as long as you're married. You do not deprive your husband or wife, deny them, defraud, resist, withhold what is rightfully theirs. Because there's this challenge of, you see, now I am married, I belong to somebody, someone is supposed to meeting my need, because now they are expecting it before they abstained, because you were not yet there, now you are here. So their mind is set on that, and then week one, week two, 2 months, 3 months, please do something about it and make sure nothing stands in the way of your intimacy with your husband or wife. Yes, at this moment, allow me drink on my cup of coffee. I'll be back in just a moment. You want to stay right there. The best is still ahead.
Pearl Apartments is located in Buziga, Munyonyo, and offers you a clean, spacious, and tranquil environment that guarantees you a memorable stay. Pearl Apartments offers fully furnished 3-bedroom apartments with ensuite bathrooms, fully equipped kitchen, well-decorated living and dining area, encircled by lush gardens and magnificent views of Lake Victoria. Each apartment has a master bedroom, twin and single room with 2 ensuite bathrooms. The property also provides high-speed Wi-Fi available throughout the property to facilitate all your work and communication needs. We also provide ample and secure parking space for all our guests, 24-hour security service, and a backup inverter. For further information, please contact us on 0702-845-985 or 0775-134-988, or you can check out on our website at www.pearlapartments.co.ug.
Delight Decor 256, making all your events decoration dreams into a reality. Located at Newmark Mall, shop number B015, opposite Shopping Equatorial. Follow us on social media for the latest trends at Delight Decor.
Thank you.
Hello. Okay.
Sit.
You're feeling pain? Are you okay? Are you fine?
Yeah, I'm okay.
How was your day? How was work?
It was good.
Okay, what's up? You're not fine. You have a headache or something?
Man, I'm okay.
Woman? Okay. When did you start calling me woman?
You a woman? Are you not a woman?
Come on, you know what I mean. When did you start calling me woman? Why are you eating a biscuit? I have
it's my supper.
Food. Your supper? When did you start eating biscuits for dinner as if you're still single? You are a married man. You have a girl life, Dad. Don't you like my cooking?
I pity men that are still getting married. Because if someone found someone like you, they would be in serious trouble.
Okay, so what is the problem now?
This time? Problem? You see, if it's about talking, I have my homies to talk to. It's about the clothes, I can take them to the dry cleaner. If it's about cleaning the house, I can ask the askari down to come and clean this house. What purpose do you serve in this house?
I hope you're not still angry about last night.
Do I look like I'm smiling?
Oh my God. I thought, like, what should we do? Like, really? What is so difficult for you to understand?
There's nothing difficult for me to understand. I know is I married a woman who has to do certain things that she's denying me.
Okay, so who is denying who in this? Because I know now you're carrying the conversation of last night now to this day. Now you're saying I'm denying you. Okay. I don't know. Maybe we should see a counselor or something.
Who's seeing a counselor?
It's very simple very simple for you to actually accept that you're not performing. You're not doing well in the bedroom matters. You're not meeting my needs. You're not, like, really, you want me to shout?
With four kids, I'm
you
not performing.
You want me to get a post and go, you know, telling everybody
with
how...
With four kids, I'm not performing.
It's not about the kids. Exactly, that's my point. For it is always, every time you come in the bed, it is, let's just do it quickly. Haphazardly, and then the kids, and then I am pregnant.
You want me to spend the whole night just playing when I have to go to work?
It's very, very, you know, disturbing to find such a man in this generation who do not take time to understand what makes a woman happy. All you want is my wife, put every time, just like that. Please, I get tired. You've overexploited me.
You can't leave if you feel exploited.
Please.
Why do I have to leave when I'm going to start arguing and pleading and quarreling and begging?
It's not about my feelings. It's not just about you.
You have everything. Good house. Children are in school.
I really don't want us to quarrel. We talked about this last night. Can't you ask your male friends how they are doing it?
At least I know they're not being treated the way you're treating me.
Go ask a kojia, an uncle, something.
Why do I need a kojia?
You know what? I don't know what to do. I have prayed. I have done everything. I have told you what I want, but you don't. You're just selfish. All you want is what makes you happy. I have a wife.
Selfish? Selfish? Do you know what I have to go through to make sure that everything is okay in this house?
You know what? If you really don't want to take time and understand what makes me happy as a woman, as far as our bedroom matters are concerned, forget this bed. Forget it. I am not going to go easy on you because I have been patient. Four kids down the road.
Don't forget that is a
Four
bed
kids.
I bought.
It's okay. I can buy my own bed. If you're not willing to
you
be
You put
the
it
husband,
in your house, not my house.
If you're not willing to be the husband in the bedroom, forget coming to the bedroom. It's fine. Take the couch. Eh? Tonight, do not come. Because I don't want to start another fight. From the living room to the bedroom, stay there. Please.
These biscuits are not nice, my love.
Welcome back from that short break. You're still in the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, Prosi Buyondo. At this time, I just want to give you the facets or what is involved in intercourse. Now, I am going to teach. Yes, I told you, as your marriage anchor, I am a teacher. So tonight, let me now teach you. I was just responding to your questions. Of course, they are numerous, but I just summarized a few that were really representative of the bulk that I get on a daily. But now let's look at the facets of intercourse. When we talk about, yes, the ministry right here, what are we actually talking about? So that if you thought maybe you knew, I know there's an angle that I'm going to present that you may not have come across. All right, I just want to make this very clear at the very start of my giving you the facets of intercourse, that sex happens in three body parts, which is spirit, soul, and body. So sex is spiritual, sex is emotional, and sex is physical. So as I'm teaching you, I want you to know that when you're in your garden, whatever you're doing must happen emotionally, spiritually, and physically. So if it is just the body, that is not sex. If it is just emotions, spiritually, no. So it has to be the three body chambers of mind, spirit, soul, and body: emotional, spiritual, physical, and then voila, a test of heaven's romance, just like that. So sex as an emotional expression. What do we mean when we say that sex is actually an emotional expression of feelings towards each other? It is actually basically that it is a celebration of positive energy brought about by the actions and reactions of a male and female with a common goal, which is happiness. In other words, sex is like the culmination of the good emotions, of the positive hormones, of the excitement, of the both of you purposing to express or make each other happy, exceptionally good, extremely sensational. So emotionally, you want to celebrate what you feel for one another. So as you're approaching, now this is the art of making love, eh? So as you're approaching your bedroom, you must come with that attitude of, I want her to feel exceptionally good, and we are celebrating what we feel for one another. That good feeling, that good emotion, that electric shock, yes, the goosebumps, the excitement that you get when you see one another, that is what you go to celebrate. So you go with that goal, we are going to achieve that. So if that is your goal, then you have to do everything to make sure that emotionally both of you are actually in a position of excitement. So let's also talk about sex in the mind, or sex actually being psychological, so that you will know. You know that the soul of man includes the mind, will, and of course emotions. And let me just concentrate on the mind and the thoughts, which requires positive thoughts, good thoughts. For example, do not come into the bedroom when you're I don't know how to call it, when you in a mood of crucifying, in a mood of accusing, in a mood of basically, you know, casting blame on each other and condemning one another. So you're in the bedroom, but you're quarreling. You're in the bedroom, apparently you want to express love, but the thoughts that are going into your mind, you're undermining one another. You know, you're suspicious, you're envious, you're jealous, you're angry. That is not an emotion to the way to a test of heaven's romance, because you must have good thoughts, positive thinking. In other words, if there is anything wrong that your spouse did, leave it in the living room. When you come into the bedroom, purpose to have good thoughts towards one another. If they have weaknesses, do not bring them. You didn't do this. You have a big tummy. I don't like your nose. I don't like. We just read the eyes, the nose, the mouth, the neck. You must appreciate everything, because I believe that by the time you pick them, you really got attracted to them. So when you're coming into the bedroom, as far as your thoughts are concerned, focus on the good things. Don't focus on the negativity, how they disappointed you, landlord, you know, the rent, you know, the car, the children are sick. Those emotions are just going to cause one lap, eh? I'm just telling you. So just make sure that your thoughts are actually positive and good, so that you're inspiring positive emotions as you're approaching this, your Garden of Eden. The other is that the couple's goal should be for a sensational encounter, which requires that you both care enough to stimulate each other psychologically. Place each other as priority at that moment, as you do not think of any other person. Some people can be in the bedroom trying to kiss you when they are imagining some ex. Let me say ex. I don't want to say side dish, you know, because here in the Garden we don't believe in that. So someone is in the bedroom trying to do for you stuff, but they have an imagination of another person. Let me pause. Someone is here to excite you. They want an outstanding performance. Apparently, they are here cherishing you, caressing, touching, but they have an imagination, a picture of somebody in the mind. So you imagine what is going on. Just imagine that kind of mess. So when I tell you, just make sure that she's priority, as in close out every other person and concentrate on your Garden and do a good job. Okay, so let me just give you also a shortcut on a bad day. Because there are people that would want to do something, but there has been a bad day and things did not go as they expected, but they're in the bedroom and someone would like, you know, to take a bite on the apple or do some extraction, but someone is not in the mood. So in case you want a shortcut to, you know, to this, you know, the taste of heaven's romance and the Garden, you may want to actually do some inspiration, especially physically. Now this is where, like I told you, the sex happens in the spirit, soul and body. So this time you have to prepare the body, do things that are going to relieve them of stress. This is where massages come in, this is where dancing, music, and your intention is not that you're putting them in the mood, but just making sure that you relieve them of all the stress, so that when they are comfortable and they are cozy and you tell them, please come and rest in my chest, let me give you a massage. Okay, can we do a steam if you have, like, you know, a steam in your house? Okay, do things that are going to excrete that negative energy. Maybe they lost something, or maybe it is a car, or maybe it is a death of somebody they love, or maybe it is a firing, or any kind of negative news. So what you do is that you have to make sure their body is very, very relaxed, so that after the relaxation, then you can inspire them to come into the Garden and you start on the farming. Okay, the other one is that you can also be the sharp one and employ some seduction. Yes, you can try to dress tantalizingly, you can cook some nice food. Yes, you can do something to tantalize, yes, something to make sure they notice that something is moving, something is changing. See his glory. You turn around and you show them the glory of the Lord. You model a little bit, or whatever it is that you think is going to catch their attention and get them to think a alongside the same lines where you're thinking, you can actually go ahead and do it. So that you actually, because seducing somebody is getting somebody to be on your side, viewing things from your own point of view. Or you can serve a dessert. I love to serve, you know, apples, and some mangoes and grapes, cut, and then you put them in yogurt. You can serve a very nice dessert, you know. Then they're like, this is very special. Are you up to something tonight? You can also be playful, because playing is one of the ways to getting somebody to be comfortable and feel okay and relax. Because your ultimate purpose is to make sure that this person is in a conducive environment or mood to give you what you want. Not coercing, not by force, not grabbing like a lion grabs its prey. All right. At this point, I just want to give you something, yeah? Something really small, which I call my tree of life for you, as I let you guys do and do some practicals, married people only, yeah? There's something that most people have been asking about, marriage anchor. Is this doable? Is this of God? Marriage anchor. Let me just read the scripture for you, and I'll tell you what it is, so that I run away before you guys crucify me for saying things on national TV. Song of Solomon chapter 2 verse 3 that says, like an apple tree among the tree of the woods, so is my beloved among the sons. I sat under his shade with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. So I'll read so that you get it. Like an apple tree among the tree of the woods. Let your imagination soar so that you come with me into this Bible verse that I am reading. So is my beloved among the sons. I sat under his shade with great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. Song of Solomon chapter 4 verse 17, and then I also read Song of Solomon chapter 5 and verse 1, which says, awake, O north wind, and come, O south, blow up my garden that its spices may flow out. Let my beloved come to his garden and eat its pleasant fruits. They use the word eat. Its pleasant fruits. I'm reading scripture. These are not my words. Okay. I have come to my garden, my sister, my spouse. I have gathered my myrrh with my spouse. I have eaten my honeycomb with my honey. They eat the honey. Okay. I have drunk my wine with my milk. Eat, O friends. Drink, yes. Drink deeply, O beloved ones. Now, their words have emphasized on purpose. The eating, the drinking, when it comes to matters of the garden, matters of worship, is really, really scripture. People that do not want to eat and drink, this Bible verse was specifically for you, because I don't know how many people I'm going to be telling by SMS or today. So let me just read the scripture. People that are thinking eating is not of God, eating is of the devil, drinking, you see, it is dirty. The only thing I can say or recommend is that just make sure that both of you are hygienically like this. You're hygienically okay, you're clean, the rest of the things, enjoy, drink, eat, and have a taste of heaven's romance. All right. I can only say that if after watching this episode you do not know how to give an outstanding performance, I don't know what to do for you. This is the best that I can do on national TV. Enjoy yourselves and make sure that you go ahead and train yourself so that you're not lacking in any way. This is the Garden of Eden with your marriage anchor, Prosy Buyondo. It's a wrap. Good night. God bless you.
Two hearts can come together and love can last forever. But now that I have found you, I believe that a miracle has come when God sends a perfect one. Now gone are all my questions about why, and I've never been so sure of anything in my life. Oh, I wonder what God was thinking.
For details, email us at themarriageanchor@gmail.com or call +256 702 767 602 or +256 782 958 875.
The Garden of Eden.
A taste of heaven's romance. When God